So the microbiome, it's taken its place at the top of 21st century scientific discoveries. It's as important to human health as the human genome, but its sphere of influence is only beginning to be understood. As we will learn tonight, the microbiome, this collection of hundreds of trillions of microbes living in and on and with our bodies, may play the puppeteer's role in pulling the strings, dictating our mental health, our resistance to disease, our vitality. We've gathered four eminent scholars who are key in solving the puzzle of the microbiome, each from a different angle. First, Rob Knight will give us a general overview of the microbiome, his latest findings, and the new American Gut Project. Eric Alm will take us through the year he spent as his own research subject. Martin Blaser will examine how our microbiome is affected by modern medical practices. And John Cryan will reveal the connection between the microbiome and the brain. Each of our illustrious guests will speak for 15 minutes, a couple minutes more possibly, but hopefully you guys will really watch it. Then they will have some time to converse together, and then you all will have, the audience will have a chance to ask questions. So we are thrilled to bring together these luminaries as they unveil secrets of the microbiome. So please join me in welcoming them to the Museum of Science, and first up will be Rob Knight.
Thanks, Lisa, for that very kind introduction and for putting together this amazing program and for the invitation to participate in it. I'm really looking forward to tonight's talks. So I'm going to say a little bit about the development of the human microbiome and what we know about it and what we know about how it changes over life. So the backdrop to everything that we're going to tell you tonight is that DNA sequencing is getting dramatically cheaper, so much so that when Steve Quake sequenced his own human genome at the end of 2009, it was literally almost a million times cheaper than it would have been at the completion of the Human Genome Project in 2001. And it's a couple of orders of magnitude cheaper than that now. So this has really led to a completely different experience of sequencing. So instead of a few years ago where a trickle of sequences escaped from behind the walls of a few major sequencing facilities, we now have a democratization of sequencing where everyone can participate, where any department and soon any lab will be able to have its own DNA sequencing equipment. The problem is that you have to do something with all those sequences. So what I'm showing you here is the data that we deal with, the A's, T's, G's, and C's, from a recent study that I did with Noah Ferrer at CU. So here's the first 9 out of 130,000 sequences we collected in this study. Here's what the tree looks like if you open it in a text editor and if you visualize it. And you can see we really have our work cut out for us trying to understand all this data. And it doesn't even help you if I tell you the design of the study. So what we were doing was biogeography, but not on the grand scale of Darwin and Wallace and the 19th century explorers, but much closer to home. So what we did is we were interested in the biogeography of the computer keyboard. And we wanted to know things like, does the space bar have more kinds of microbes just because it's larger? Right? Are the keys a desert where few microbes survive compared to the lush valleys of your fingerprints? And so what we did is we took 3 people and sampled all the keys on their keyboards and then all of their fingertips. And so what we found was amazing. Here's another view of exactly the same data I showed you on the last slide that makes the patterns immediately clear. So now each point on this graph is an entire microbial community, either from a fingertip or from a key. And what you can see is the great clusters for the first, the second, and the third person. If I take the same data and I color it according to what's a key versus what's a fingertip, you see essentially no separation. So by improved visualization, we can tell immediately that each of us has a unique skin community that we transfer to our keyboards as we type. Now, as part of the same study, we're able to match the palm of the hand up to the computer mouse that person uses with up to 90% accuracy. So this came out in the journal PNAS a couple of years ago, but more importantly, it was on CSI Miami, so you really know it's true. Anyway, so what are these microbes doing for us, or to us, you might be wondering? The observation that the body is teeming with life is not new. So Antony van Leeuwenhoek, as long ago as the 1680s, had already observed through improved microscopy that microbes were everywhere. And one of the things he was first interested in was microbes on the human teeth. Now, so in fact, he began with his own teeth. This, of course, was in the days before ethics boards. Now we're a lot more concerned about privacy and so forth. But he started by looking at his own teeth, didn't see anything especially interesting there. He then went on to examine two female subjects, widely believed to have been his wife and daughter. Didn't see anything especially interesting there either. And then ultimately went out to the streets of Delft, where he lived, where he was able to recruit three men who swore they had never brushed their teeth in their lives. And so, and from those three people came the first recognizable reports of bacteria anywhere, and they were associated with the human body. So we now know a lot more reasons why you should care about your microbes specifically, now that we can identify them using DNA sequencing techniques that put a name to all these microbes and tell us about their functions. So, for example, whether or not Tylenol is toxic to your liver depends sensitively on a particular group of sulfate-reducing microbes that some people have and other people lack. Now, if you're a fruit fly at least, microbes determine who you want to mate with. This hasn't been replicated in humans yet, but perhaps it's just a matter of time. It also turns out that everyone's anecdotal experience of camping is true, and different people are differentially attractive to mosquitoes. And a lot of the reason for that is different volatile organic compounds that are produced by different kinds of skin bacteria that vary person to person. We also know a lot more about the gut microbiota in particular than we did a few hundred years ago. So, for example, there's about as many E. coli in your gut as there are people on Earth, on the order of a few billion of them. But it's important to remember that only a tiny fraction of the microbes in your gut are E. coli or any of its close relatives. The vast majority are things like Firmicutes and Bacteroidetes and Actinobacteria and other organisms that are very different from E. coli. So it's not a dominant member of the gut. It's just really good at growing in a petri dish. It's also important to remember that any two people you pick, no matter what differences in phenotype they might have, are going to be 99.9% plus identical in terms of their human genome, right? But if you look at the bacterial world, you can take even two E. coli cells from the same species, and their genomes can be up to 40% different in terms of gene content. So what does this mean? Well, at least at the DNA level, what it means is that perhaps you are not a beautiful and unique snowflake, right? perhaps it's in your symbiotic microbes that all of that diversity lies. And so all of this diversity starts to raise questions about how human we are in the first place, because each of us consists of about 10 trillion human cells, and depending on what you count, about 20,000 human genes. Whereas we carry with us as many as 100 trillion microbial cells, mostly bacteria in the gut. And then the microbial gene catalog has been estimated at 2 to 20 million microbial genes. And then, as I mentioned, we're all essentially the same in terms of our human genes, but the extent to which our microbial genes are similar or different to one another has been much less explored until recently. So how do we know about all these microbes? Well, in this context, it's really important to remember that our world, to a first approximation, is a microbial world. So this is a picture of the tree of life from Norm Pace's lab, where the branches on the tree represent changes in bacterial sequences, and then the tips represent modern species, and then the further back you go, the more ancient the common ancestor. And so on the scale, this is us, for example. This is corn, so if you had cornflakes for breakfast, that's how much of the diversity of the tree you were covering. And this is a mushroom, right? And essentially all of life, including all the archaea, all the bacteria, and most of the eukaryotes, the cells with nuclei, are microbial, not the plants and animals and fungi that you see around you. And the vast majority of these microbes, we still don't know how to culture. All we know about them is their DNA sequences. So how we get at them is with this molecule called ribosomal RNA, which is part of the ribosome, the factory in the cell that makes proteins. And what's unique about it is that it's found in all species. It has fast and slow evolving regions, so we can tell apart closely related species, but also relate very distantly related species. And there's large pre-existing databases we can use to match the new sequences we find up against. So what we do is we do direct environmental sequencing, where what we do is we get samples and extract the DNA from them. So maybe the red tube comes from your left hand and the blue tube from your right. We use the polymerase chain reaction to amplify the genes. Then we sequence them, and then we match them up to other genes that they're similar to in the database that come from organisms that we know something about. And so my lab's developed this computational pipeline called CHIME, which stands for Quantitative Insights into Microbial Ecology, which is open source, free for everyone to use, and allows you to do this kind of data analysis downstream. So basically, we tag the genes from different samples with a DNA barcode that we introduce. We can mix them together and sequence them on high-throughput sequencing instruments, and then we can tell what sample each of the sequences came from when we pull them and mix them together. So then we can clip them off, align them, build phylogenetic trees, and use the separation on the trees to cluster the samples, like on that plot I showed you before of the fingertips and the keys. So doing this for the whole body, in 2009 we got the first overall map of what the different communities on your body look like with respect to one another. And so what we're looking at here is data from 6 subjects who were sampled at 27 sites on the body, which as you can imagine is a lot of places to stick a Q-tip the first thing in the morning. And so what we see is a very distinct cluster for the mouth, a very distinct cluster for the gut, and then the skin's a lot more spread out, as is the hair, the nostrils, and so on. The clustering by body site is more important than by sex or by person, with one exception. So one of our people showed up on the day of sampling and said, by the way, I was on the antibiotic Cipro a couple of weeks ago for a sinus infection. Do you think that'll matter? And I said, well, it's too late to recruit someone else at this point, so I guess we'll find out. And that person was completely different in the mouth, in the gut, and in all their skin sites from everyone else in the study. But then 3 months later, they were back in the distribution with everybody else. And so in the next talk, Eric will be telling you a lot more about these fine-scale changes in the microbiota over time. But this started to give us our first overall map of microbes on the human body. And you can probably see a bunch of left-right symmetry here in the pie charts. Basically, 2 samples from the same body site are less different than 2 samples, from the same site are less different than 2 samples from different sites. Within a site, 2 samples from the same person are less different than from 2 different people. And samples a day apart are less different than those 3 months apart. Then the mouth was the most stable place we looked at, the skin the least stable, and then the gut was in between. So, and then in the Human Microbiome Project, which is a $175 million NIH effort to characterize the microbiome, we see essentially the same thing, but with a lot more people and a lot more confidence in the results across different populations. And the main things to see here, so the different colors represent different kinds of microbes, the different habitats like the gut, the skin, and the vagina, and the mouth are very different from one another. But then you can also see that for any microbe that's really common in one person, you can find some other person where there's hardly any of it. So we see this immense diversity between different people. And these are the papers that were published last year in Nature. So then this brings us to the question of how we can see microbial change over time and space. And you might be wondering where our microbes come from in the first place. And if you have dogs or kids, you might have some suspicions about that. And with our collaborator, Maria Gloria Dominguez at the University of Puerto Rico, we were able to do some sampling of babies' first microbes, looking at mothers an hour before they delivered, and then looking at their babies 20 minutes after birth. And so what we see is that unlike adults, where their body habitats are very differentiated, in the babies they basically all look the same, and they depend on delivery mode. So if you came out the regular way, all your microbes look like the vaginal community. If you were delivered by C-section, all your microbes instead look like skin. And here's another view of those data, where in pink we have all the skin, all the habitats from all the vaginally delivered babies, and then the vaginal samples in red. Over here, we have all of the skin samples from all the mothers in dark blue, then all habitats from all the C-section babies in light blue. And then up here we have the mother's oral communities, which are very different. And then with Ruth Lay at Cornell, we tracked the development of the microbiome of one infant from the meconium, the first stool that was produced, weekly for about the first 2.5 years of life. And you can see this, and you can see how it comes to resemble the mother's microbiota. And there's also a steady increase in diversity of the microbiome over that time. This is just looking at stool samples. But by combining this data with the Human Microbiome Project data, we can get some more insight into how that change works. And so, if I show you this movie of how the microbiome develops, what we have here is from the HMP, we have all the data from adults, from the gut, from the mouth, from the vagina in pink, and then from the skin in green. And so you can see that the baby starts off with a gut community resembling the vaginal community, which makes sense given the delivery mode. You have some transitions between the vaginal and the skin community, and you can see that it's not a steady progression. It's really bouncing back and forth a lot as it develops over the time course. And so we're going, let me just move that over a little. So we're going from birth up until 27 months at the end of the time series. Now, one thing you're about to see is that the baby has antibiotics for an ear infection, and that causes sudden, there it goes, sudden and very marked change in the microbiome in the gut, but then it starts to come back, and by the time we get up to 27 months, you can see that the community is pretty much up there with the adult stool community. And so by combining these data sets, we can start to understand much better the developmental trajectory of individuals. And we can also look at this across cultures. So what we're looking at here is the approach to the adult microbiome replicated in a population from Malawi in red, a population from Venezuela in green, and a population from the US in blue. Although one thing that's interesting to note is that the adult populations wind up being very different from one another. So this is the US population. These are the Malawians and Amerindians. And so the question is, what is it that's causing these differences? Is it primarily diet or host genetics or environmental exposure? And we don't know the answers to these questions yet because all the populations differ in all these different variables. And so a lot more work needs to be done to untangle these different factors. So I'm just going to tell you a little bit about how the microbiome relates to genetics and health. And you might be wondering whether all this diversity matters. And for mice, it certainly does. So with Jeff Gordon's group, we've been studying these leptin mutant mice, which are much fatter than a normal mouse. They also have a radically altered microbial community in the gut relative to wild-type mice. And so you might be wondering whether that change in the bacteria is a cause or an effect of the obesity. It turns out that you can take the community from the obese mouse, transplant it into a germ-free mouse that's genetically normal but has no microbes of its own. That other mouse will also get fat. And the same is true for a different model, the toll-like 5 receptor knockout mouse, which is lacking a normal component of the innate immune system that we worked with Andrew Gewirtz on. So you can see that it's a lot fatter. It's got larger fat pads in males and females, higher triglycerides and cholesterol in the blood, high blood pressure, and again, a radically altered microbial community relative to a wild-type mouse. But in this case, what's going on is it's not an energy balance phenotype, so the OB community is more efficient at extracting nutrition from the diet. With these mice, what's going on is something different. It turns out that they actually eat more than a wild-type mouse does, and the same is true for a genetically normal mouse that you transfer those microbes into. So in this case, it's having a behavioral effect rather than a metabolic effect. And John is going to tell you a whole lot about additional behavioral effects of the microbiome in the last talk. But what this means is remember that you have a whole lot more bacterial cells in you than you have your own cells, and they may potentially be outvoting you when it comes time to make choices at the cafeteria. So you might be wondering if this mouse stuff extends to humans. Jeff Gordon's group has shown that the longer people are on the longer obese people are on a diet, the more they come to resemble lean people microbially, and then the more weight they lose, the bigger the change in their bacterial community. And Dan Knights, who was a really talented grad student in my lab, who's now working with Ram Xavier at Harvard, was able to show that we can classify people as lean or obese with 90% accuracy based on their gut microbes. And the reason why this is really impressive is that with genome-wide association studies, there's a whole lot of human genes associated with obesity, but you can only predict whether someone's lean or obese with about 58% accuracy based on their human genes, whereas you can do it with 90% accuracy based on their bacterial genes. So can we actually exploit this to manipulate the microbiome to cure disease? Well, one really interesting question is whether we can do something not just about obesity, but about malnutrition. So in another project with Jeff Gordon's lab, funded by the Gates Foundation, we've been looking at populations in Malawi and Bangladesh. So this photo was taken by Tanya Yatsunenko, one of Jeff's grad students at the field site we work with in Malawi. And although food is scarce in this population, you'll notice that they do, for example, have access to cell phones. And the remarkable fact is that there are now over 5 billion activated cell phones on Earth, which is really impressive when you consider there's only about 7 billion people. And a lot of the reason for this is Moore's law. The decrease in the cost of computation means that processing the digital signals is effectively so cheap that it's free. And this isn't just true in Bangladesh, in Malawi, for example. So I took this photo in Bangladesh last year in Dhaka, where even in relatively poor parts of the city, you can buy a sizable hunk of a cow, and then right next to it, you can get your cell phone minutes recharged. And so what we're looking at here is the decline in the cost of computation, which is this white line. But in the time that computation has dropped in cost by a factor of about 100, DNA sequencing has dropped in cost by a factor of about 1 million. So the question is, can we come up with a kind of personalized medicine based not on subtle differences in the human genome, but based on these very obvious differences in the human microbiome? And so we're starting to do this now by taking microbes from malnourished children on the Gates project, and then from obese adults on an NIH project, transplanting them into mice, and then looking at how those mice gain or lose weight, depending on whose microbes they got. And the results from this are just beautiful. So this axis is time, this axis is the microbial community. And so five mice colonized from the same human subject start off looking pretty much the same on mouse chow. When you switch them to the Malawi diet, which is about 90% corn and 10% leaves, you see the sudden change in the microbial community that you can just model with an exponential decay curve. When you give them the ready-to-use therapeutic food, so the peanut butter-based supplement that's used in the clinic, they start to recover. But after 2 weeks, when you switch back to the Malawi diet, they go back to that same state. And with Jeff's lab, we were recently able to show that mice with individual transplants, either from healthy children or from children with kwashiorkor, a severe nutritional deficiency, respond very differently. So the mice that get the quash community lose weight very rapidly and they're really sick. But then when you supplement them with the therapeutic food, you get this rapid improvement, whereas the mice that are colonized from the healthy child show very little change. And then this is coupled to a very profound change in the microbiota. And so what we can see is that the responses in mice can potentially tell us something about what will or won't work for an individual. And so obviously the germ-free mice, where you're raising them in a bubble and keeping them away from everything except the microbes you supply, are very expensive. But the idea is to move from this to an in vitro system and then ultimately to a computational system where you can predict for the microbes what diet or drug or other intervention will work for individual people. So basically the idea is to develop a restoration ecology of the gut. And it's kind of like your lawn, where the idea is that you might have an initially flourishing ecosystem that's then ravaged by diarrhea or antibiotics or other issues. And then left to itself, maybe you have weeds running wild if you just let whatever recolonizes recolonize. Then the question is, what should you do? Should you seed in good microbes with probiotics? Should you promote good microbe growth with prebiotics? Or should you use bacteria therapy, like has been very successful for Clostridium difficile infection, where you're transplanting the whole ecosystem? And then to what extent can you restore something approaching, but maybe not quite reaching, the diversity of the original ecosystem? So what have we learned from all this? Well, we've learned that different body sites, different people, and different populations are incredibly diverse in terms of their microbes. We've learned that the microbes can cause, as well as being effective, really large differences in phenotype. And we've also found that the prospects for personalized medicine based on the microbiome are looking really good, just because there's so much diversity there in their microbial genes as opposed to your human genes. And you might be wondering how you can get involved with this. And so Time magazine, at the start of 2007, made you, as in the producer of user-generated content on Wikipedia or YouTube or other websites, the person of the year. And it's literally true that you can do this for your microbes now. So for example, if you go to Google and you type in American gut, and I'll just do that, what you get is your first link. Is a link to this project where you can actually start to make use of this information, of these techniques developed in the Human Microbiome Project, and find out about what's in your own gut microbiota. And so, if you click there, this is a crowdfunded campaign that you can potentially contribute to, either in terms of money or in terms of microbes, or both, to really help to understand what these differences in the microbial community are doing and how they correlate to diet, physiological state, and a whole lot of other things. So what's really exciting about this is it gives you the opportunity for the first time to participate in this microbiome research as opposed to just reading about it in the newspapers. So what can you so basically, there's a lot of these questions about the effects of diet, lifestyle, pets, kids, and so forth that are largely unknown. And by signing up, your microbes, or perhaps those of your child or pet, might help us understand a range of diseases that are now being linked to the microbiome. So with that, I'd just like, and we will, of course, protect your privacy to the extent possible, at least so far, we don't think there are any risks associated with making your microbial genetic data available. That's very important to mention, and all of this work is approved by our institutional review board. So with that, I'd just like to thank the large number of people in my lab, both current and former members, and our huge number of collaborators across these different projects. And I won't read all these names, but I just want to point out how highly collaborative microbiome research is, and I think that's a theme that will emerge in the other talks. So with that, I'll hand things over to Eric and just say thank you for your attention.
Well, it's really great to get to talk to you guys about some of the work that we've been doing in the microbiome, and absolutely fantastic to be sandwiched in between some of the really the stars of the field. So I should say, I'm going to tell you a story about my own exploration of the microbiome. And actually, Rob had a key part in this. We had decided to kind of get into the microbiome and do this crazy project, but we really didn't have the infrastructure up and ready to do all the molecular biology and the genomics. So all the work I'm going to talk about was actually sequenced by Rob. So there's really this, like Rob mentioned, a highly collaborative community. So let me start the story a few years ago. And this was an idea that we had. You know, I didn't really work in the microbiome field, but it was clear that it was going to start to be really important. You know, I was kind of a microbiologist, and a grad student of mine and myself had an idea. You know, we should do a study to figure out what are all the daily factors, daily lifestyle choices that we make. What are all the things we decide to eat or not eat, and how do they affect our microbiome? And what we decided to do is we said, we need to get a bunch of people enrolled in a study where we can track every aspect of their lives, okay? And we want to know, what time they go to bed, how much sleep they got. Was it a good sleep? Was it not? We want to know every morsel of food they eat. We want to know what is their mood? When does their mood change? We want to know it all in real time. We want to know if they travel. Anything we can document. We came up with a list of about 300 different factors that we wanted to trace. And of course, we wanted a piece of every one of their bowel movements, right? And we wanted to do this for about a year so we would get the full exposure to anything a person might go through. So it wasn't actually a real funded project. I was using some money out of my startup funding. So we couldn't actually pay people, and surprisingly, nobody signed up to do this, okay? So we decided to do a pilot study, okay? So Lawrence and I started, collecting our own samples, and Lawrence said one day, hey, could I, if I write an iPhone app to collect all this data so we can record it in real time, can I charge it to your grant when I buy an iPhone? I said, sure, okay. So now if anybody's interested, there's an app for that, okay? this was the result. So on the top, you see my gut microbiome in 2009, okay? And on the bottom, you see my student's microbiome. And the first impression that I want you guys to come away with is, the x-axis here is time. So, we start in the beginning of 2009 over here, and this is the end. I could pull any one, so all the different colors there represent different bacterial species in the gut. I could pull any day out of this time series, and you would know if it came from me or from my student, right? Because they're so different, okay? So the one thing that told us is, well, the microbiome, although there's fluctuation day to day, the variation day to day is not too different than the variation month to month or from the beginning of the year to the end. So considering how different my gut microbiome is from my students and from all of yours, it's kind of remarkable that it's stable over such a long period of time. Okay, but we wanted to know, we wanted to record all of these factors, so what ended up influencing the microbiome? Well, diet influenced it to some extent, and I'm showing you one of the strongest correlations we had. So if you look here, you can see that the amount of fiber that you consume today affects the amount of, these are three different species of bacteria that are going to be in your stool tomorrow. Okay. So this was one of the stronger correlations. Here's a full list of all the correlations we saw. And so at the end of the day, it was actually a relatively small number of the 300 different factors that we tracked had any influence that was statistically detectable on the microbiome, okay? And even some of these things that had a strong correlation, they added up to a very small percentage, which is why, you know, day after day, you see my gut microbiome and my students' gut microbiome have, you know, a very characteristic appearance. So some of the things that mattered, fiber seemed to matter quite a bit, okay? It's true, listen to your dentist, okay? So if you floss today, you're gonna have less S. mutans, the cause of dental caries in your teeth tomorrow, okay? So that was important. And the other interesting thing I'll note is that all of these correlations had a time lag of one. So the things you do to your body today show up in your microbiome tomorrow. Right, which makes sense, and told us we're not finding spurious correlations. The only thing that was correlated with the same day was stool hardness was correlated with these bacteria up here. Yeah, we went there. Okay. All right. So here's a different view of the same type of data. So on the x-axis here, I'm showing you time from the beginning of the study to the end. And on the y-axis here, I'm showing you all the different bacterial species. Now, the red colors indicate there was more of that bacteria on that particular day, and the blue colors indicate there was less of that bacteria on that particular day, okay? So this is my student's microbiome. And about a third of the way through the study, he said, Eric, I've got this great opportunity. My wife is going to do an internship. She was in medical school in Bangkok, and I want to go and hang out with her for the summer. I said, fine. Relieve you from your duties as a grad student, but you have to stay in the study. So we bought him a little mini fridge to store his samples in, much to his wife's delight. And he took that with him to Bangkok. So we got to we got all this interesting data. So almost as soon as he got off the plane, and we've all been there, right? Traveler's diarrhea. He was attacked by a nasty cocktail of about three different enteric pathogens, one of which I'd never heard of. And that's what you see up here at the top. Now, at the same time, all of these bacteria here, part of his normal commensal gut flora, all went away. Okay, but what was even more remarkable is within a few days of him getting off the plane to return back to the United States, his gut microbiome went pretty much back to normal. Okay, now I'm going to tell you another little vignette. So this is a similar plot of my own microbiome. So about two-thirds of the way through the study, a friend of mine invited me out to a brunch. I happily accepted, but I made the mistake of ordering the special French toast, okay? And 48 hours later, I was deep in the throes of a really awful salmonella infection, okay? And those are these bacteria down here. Now, what you're gonna see is right after my salmonella infection, you can see all of these bacteria disappear. And unlike Lawrence, when he got back to the United States, his gut repopulated, only a few of these bacteria came back, and many of them were permanently sort of banished from my gut, and they were replaced with these bacteria here, some of which had not been there, some of which had been there, but at a very low abundance. Okay, so what we see is there's this remarkable stability to the microbiome, but there's a few things like traveling to new environments, being exposed to new things, being exposed to bad French toast that can really kind of toast your microbiome. Okay, but then after this this major event, you can see the stability is still there. And that's sort of one of the open questions, like how is it that our bodies keep a stable microbiome? Does it have something to do with the immune system? And if so, what's the mechanism? So about the same time I was working on this, my wife actually works in the same field. So she was at the Broad Institute working on the Human Microbiome Project, and they had the idea of going through all of the sequence data that had been generated and mapping it against known bacteria. And every time they did that, they put a mark down on the genome position. And so what you end up with is something that looks like one of those bar charts that you have at the supermarket, right? The food label tags. And so she could generate this unique fingerprint for each microbe that's much higher resolution than just the species level information that I was showing you before. And she wanted to know, is it really the same exact strain of bacteria in each person, okay? And what she found is that, oh gosh, you know, they all look different, okay? But when she looked closer, and she found the samples for people who had come in for repeat visits, you can see that the barcode is exactly the same. So not only is the microbiome stable over time, we have the same species, you know, a month or a year later, but it's that same strain of bacteria that you can tell by looking at that barcode, that fingerprint. Okay? So does that mean if it's highly stable, it's even the same strain, that our microbiomes don't change over time? Well, I want to tell you about a story that came out, a really interesting story, this paper, we call it the sushi gene paper. And here were some folks that were looking at an enzyme that's found in those nori sushi wrappers. Okay, this is one of the genes that breaks down the carbohydrates, if you guys eat sushi, that seaweed wrapper. Well, they wanted to see where else is this gene found. They found it in marine bacteria. And the marine bacteria had actually stolen the gene. It had been horizontally transferred from the algae that produced the carbohydrate. The bacteria stole it, and they're using the gene to digest the carbohydrate and eat the algae. But the other thing they found is there were four bacteria that were isolated from the human body that also had this gene. And guess what? They were all from Japanese people. Said, Japanese people do eat a lot of those sushi wrappers, so you know maybe there's some connection. So they went to a giant database of DNA from the guts of Japanese folks. They found this gene was really, really common. They went to an even bigger database of North Americans, and they couldn't find a single copy. Okay, so what they inferred was that the gene was stolen by bacteria, stolen from the algae. And then those bacteria were eaten by a human, presumably a Japanese individual, a long time ago. And the microbes in that person's gut stole the gene from the guys who had stole it from the algae. And we thought this is really interesting. We want to go through the whole, you know, GenBank, the list of all the DNA that's out there, and find out, you know, has this ever happened before? Because we could find 5 or 10 examples, I would be thrilled. Well, my students went. They did this big calculation. They came back a week later and said, Eric, yeah, we're done. We found 80,000 examples of this. Said, that's crazy, okay. But what was more surprising is almost every example they found where DNA had been transferred from one organism to another very recently, all of those organisms were isolated from the human body. So what we uncovered was that there's this massive network of gene exchange where bacteria is, you know, exchanging genes back and forth like crazy, and it's all bacteria that are isolated from our bodies. Our bodies are sort of a hotspot for this sort of exchange of genetic material. So here, about a year ago, we constructed this, the first sort of global map of how and when bacteria are exchanging genes, bacteria from different environments. And you can see all of this exchange, the warmer colors mean there's more gene exchange. These are happening between bacteria that were isolated from the human body, and especially bacteria that were isolated from the same site on the human body. Okay. So one particular kind of gene exchange that we're really interested in is exchange of antibiotic resistance genes. This is the process by which, you know, bacteria acquires this, and a potentially bad pathogenic bacteria can become an even worse pathogen because now they're not susceptible to antibiotics. So we wanted to go back and look and see, of all that gene exchange, does any lead to resistance? And so now in the bottom half of this same plot, the warmer colors means that a higher percentage of those genes that are being shared confer resistance to at least one antibiotic. Okay, so I want to draw your attention to the one category where we saw exchange between something that was not a human bug and something that was human. We saw it between bacteria isolated from our food and bacteria isolated from our livestock. Those do seem to exchange genes with a bacteria in the human body. And when we take a closer look, we find out that over 60% of those gene exchanges include at least one gene that's known to confer antibiotic resistance. So I think this starts to build a strong case that we need to think about. Is it really safe to continue to feed antibiotics, subtherapeutic levels, to our livestock? Because we know now that those genes that confer antibiotic resistance to those antibiotics are making it into the genes that live in our guts. So with that, I'll conclude. Thank you for your attention. And I'll pass it along to Marty Blaser.
This, perhaps. No. Backyard.
This one. Rob, how many windows do you have open here?
Is this one?
This one?
Yeah. You see a slideshow here. Okay, great. So thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be invited here to speak with such outstanding scholars. I'm going to tell what you're going to hear from me is a continuation of what Rob and Eric have been talking about, but with a different slant. So I'm going to talk about perturbations of the microbiome, and I'd like to begin with this slide, which is a satellite map of Greenland, 10 years apart. And you can see that the ice is melting. And we take this as a representation of global warming. And I would say that global warming is a change in our macroecology due to man-made events. And what I'm going to talk about is a change in our microecology, which I believe is of considerable scale. So let's begin at the beginning, and it reminds me of Rob's Tree of Life. What we know is that animals have been colonized by residential microorganisms, mostly bacteria, ever since they were animals. That goes back at least 500 million years. And we know that these microbes live in particular niches in the bodies of their host, that many of them are conserved among individuals across a species, but some of them are very specific, and that includes the people in this room, as Rob has told us. And we also know that many of them are persistent. They're acquired early in life, and they persist for the whole life of the host. Now, here's another way of looking at the diagram that Rob talked about. This is a microbiologist's view of the human body. Human cells, let's see if this works as a pointer, yep. Human cells, 10 to the 13th. Microbial cells, 10 to the 14th. It asks the question, who are we? Here's a geneticist view of the human body. Human genes, 23,000. Bacterial genes, 8 million and counting. Who are they? So we have been interested in a series of biological questions, spurred by Rob's keyboard study. What is the identity of the microbes that populate their host? What are they doing? How is the host responding to them? What are the forces that maintain equilibrium among the populations? Why don't they kill us or we kill them? And what are the unique characteristics of each individual? And we're particularly interested in this question about equilibrium. And a number of years ago, we developed a model of coevolution. And in a sense, the nature of coevolution is that we have organisms that signal the host and the host signals back. They know how to talk to each other. They communicate through their chemical and physical signals, and this produces an equilibrium. Our mathematical modeling showed this was very robust, it's resilient, but the question I want to discuss today is what happens when we perturb that? Eric showed some examples of it. And I want to take a couple of examples to discuss this. First, I want to show this organism living in the human stomach. It's called Helicobacter pylori. And we now know that this is one of those organisms that's acquired very early in life, and it's the dominant organism in the human stomach when it's there. We know that it's been present for more than 100,000 years in humans. It's been present in every human population that has been looked for. It persists, as I mentioned. It's been highly prevalent until recently. Virtually everybody used to have it. And so we look at this slide of Helicobacter prevalence in the United States in two large national studies, NHANES 3 and NHANES 4, in men and women. And what the data show is that people born early in the 20th century frequently had Helicobacter. Most of them did. But by the time we had people born in the late 1990s, very few did. In fact, less than 6% of our children have Helicobacter pylori today. And from these and other data, it's clear that this bacterium that has been with humans at least 100,000 years has largely disappeared over the course of a century. So if one organism is disappearing, maybe others are disappearing as well. And so we considered an idea which we've called the disappearing microbiota hypothesis, that with changing human ecology beginning in the late 19th century, there have been dramatic changes that have affected the transmission and maintenance of our indigenous microbiota. These changed circumstances have affected the composition, and the loss of Helicobacter is an example of that. The changed composition affects human physiology. We have lots of examples of that, and thus disease risk. And very importantly, the loss of ancestral bacteria that usually are acquired early in life is especially important because early life is a developmentally critical point. So how do babies get their microbiome? Rob introduced the subject. Mostly we get it from our mothers. Passage through the birth canal, skin-to-skin contact, mouth-to-breast contact, oral-oral licking, pre-mastication of foods. But moms are exposed to many different kinds of environmental effects, and now the babies are too, such as cesarean section, which Rob talked about, and bathing, and dental amalgam, and especially early life antibiotics, which I'm going to talk about. And we've, with Stan Falco, we developed a hypothesis that not only is our microbiome changing, but it's cumulative across generation. Each of our modern generations is growing up with a smaller complement of our ancient organisms, and we're just stepping down. We don't know the scale at this point. So this is the slide that Rob showed you of the studies of the Malawians, Amerindians, and people in the US, showing that children are born in life with very few organisms, and then there seems to be a kind of stability in adult life. And we can see again how the organisms are acquired in childhood. And this is the other slide that Rob showed, which I found really fascinating from their work, looking at how long it takes to develop the adult microbiome. And what's clear is that there's a big divergence between the microbiome of young kids and adults, but over time it's getting less and less. And essentially this process is done by the age of 3 years old. So this seems to be the critical time. Now, I want to spend really most of the time talking about obesity, because all of you know obesity is epidemic in the United States and all over the developed world. And this is illustrated by these maps by the CDC, looking at the percentage of adults who are obese from 1989 to 2010. In 1989, there was no state where more than 14% of the adults were obese. By 2010, there's no state with less than 20% obesity, and on average, it's about 30%. The two important points I want to emphasize is that it's happening all over the country. It's widespread. And this is only 21 years. This is happening enormously rapidly. And the diet calorie hypothesis is not sufficient to explain this. So how can we explain it? Well, I want to go after the lead that Eric talked about, because we know that agricultural practices are different than they used to be. In fact, for the last 60 years, farmers have been feeding low doses of antibiotics, what we call subtherapeutic antibiotic treatment, to farm animals deliberately to fatten them up. The farmers learned that this worked across a wide variety of vertebrate species, a wide variety of antibiotics that differed in class, target, and spectrum. They learned that the younger you started it, the more profound the effect. And so we began a series of studies to try to model this in mice, where we compared antibiotic or stat-fed mice to controls, and we measured things. So this is the results of some of our first studies that were led by Il-Sung Cho, who is a postdoctoral fellow in the lab. When Il-Sung began using several different antibiotic regimens, he didn't find any difference in the total weight. But when we looked at the amount of fat, we could begin to see differences. And these mice, given antibiotics, any of these regimens, had more fat than the controls. And we've seen this now in a whole series of studies, which I'll show you. This work has been continued by Lori Cox, a graduate student, and she's done really seminal work. In Il-Sung's study, we looked at the microbes that were present in the gut of these mice. We found that it was a deep branching, two very profound branches. When we looked at the distribution on the branches, we found it was very non-random. All the stat are in this lower branch. And when we look at percent body fat, it goes with the stat as well. So Laurie continued these studies, where she looked at both male and female mice and asked, what does it look like over the course of life? And if we look at body fat, we see that by the age of 16 weeks, the two paths diverge. Red is stat, black is control. And females, it happens at 20 weeks, and it's conserved over life. She began to sequence the data, and in brief, again, there's a deep branching, and this branch is all control. This branch is almost completely stat. And what's important here is that this difference is at 4 weeks. This is before the microbiota changed, before the weight changed, and before the fat changed. The change in the microbiota preceded the change in fat. Laurie did another experiment, which we call fat stat, in which at 16 weeks, she put half the mice on a high-fat diet. And the black lines are the controls, the red lines are the stat. And if we look at the males at total mass, we can see that there's an increase in mass, whether they had a normal chow or high-fat diet. And if we just look here at the fat mass, we can see that when we put the mice on high fat, they increase their fat. But when you gave them high fat and antibiotics, they increased even more. And in the female mice, it's dramatic. These mice had 5 grams of fat and on the high fat diet. And when they were given high fat and antibiotics, they had 11 grams. They tripled the amount of fat. We can measure the fat. This is an MRI. These are MRIs of mice. We can see that the fat is infiltrating their liver as well. Shingo Yamanishi, a postdoctoral fellow, looked at the genes involved in the liver that were responding to the changes in the intestine. He used a variety of different pathways, and it can be summarized here, where we look at genes involved in fatty acid metabolism and lipid metabolic processes. Blue is under, red is over. You can see big differences between stat and control, and involving many of the pathways in intermediate metabolism that allows the liver to form fat. We can summarize those studies by saying that antibiotics mediated differential selection of the colonic microbiota. It changed the composition. This changed representation of fatty acid genes and increased synthesis, increased fat by the liver, and incorporation into fat tissue. In those studies, we gave the mice antibiotics for their whole life, but we wanted to see what's the critical window, how much is enough. And so Laurie did an experiment where she either gave them for their whole life or not at all, or just for the first 4 weeks of life or 8 weeks. And here we're looking at mass, lean mass, and fat mass. The black line is the control. Even 4 weeks was sufficient to produce this effect in all three of our measurements. Shingo Yamanishi continued to do microarrays, and we've done other assays looking at the immune cells in the intestine. Again, you can see this big color difference in important central pathways of immune system processing. So the early life antibiotics not only are changing metabolic phenotypes, they're changing immune phenotypes as well. So as Rob described in the work of Jeff Gordon, we decided to do the same thing. Were the antibiotics doing it, or was the microbiota doing it? So we transferred microbiota from stat mice or control mice to germ-free mice, which we could buy from Taconic Farms in a bubble, and we transferred it to them. And then we asked what happened to their mass, and the black line is the control. The stat microbiota made these mice grow faster, and there was more fat. So we could transfer the phenotype just with the microbes. Lori has been studying the qualities of the microbes over time. We're looking at the control and the stat over time at five different taxonomic levels. This is the equivalent of being in an airplane and looking at from 35,000 feet to 10 feet, and we can see big differences. And we're looking at these very carefully to understand the candidates for what's causing this. Now, that's the farm model, but most of the antibiotics that we, and we get antibiotics from the agricultural use of antibiotics. We humans are getting it as a consequence of that. But we're really also concerned about all those courses of antibiotics that we're giving our kids. In 2010, we gave our kids about 43 million courses of antibiotics, largely for mild infections. And so we developed a second model. The first model was stat, low doses of antibiotics continuously. Yael Noble, a student in the lab, developed the PAT model, where we gave three pulses of antibiotics as if we were treating the ear infections on these mice. We designed the dose so that it would be equivalent. Here's the study design, three courses of amoxicillin, the most widely used drug in childhood, Tylosin. This is the macrolide, or the Z-pack of mice, and we also did a mixture. Here are the pulses early in life. Black line is control. Here's weight gain. These mice gain weight more rapidly. Same thing that we saw in stat. We also looked at bone growth, and we saw early bone growth as well, and we had seen it in stat as well. So it's not only changing muscle and fat, it's changing bone as well. We looked at by sequencing the microbiota, we looked at the amount of diversity in the microbiota, and perhaps this is the most important slide I'm going to show you today. Here we cut off all the specimens at the same depth, 3,000 sequences. Here are the moms. They had about 800 species in their GI tract. Here, after one dose pulse of antibiotics, here are the control mice. They look a lot like mom. Amoxicillin, it's suppressed, and the Tylosin, the macrolide, it's very suppressed. And as the experiment progressed, and we put them all on high fat here, the mice never regained their diversity. Even 100 days after the last antibiotic dose. And 100 days is a long time in a mouse. They never regain their diversity. We can look at the data a different way. Alex Alexienko, an informaticist in our group, decided that the best way to cluster the data was into four clusters. He did a formal analysis. And this is the four clusters of the 338 fecal specimens in the mice that we looked at, four different colors. Now let's look at it over time. Time one are the mothers. They're all in the green group. This time is after one pulse of antibiotics. The controls look like mom. Amoxicillin looks like mom. But after one dose, the macrolide, they're all in this cluster of bacteria. After three pulses, some of the amoxicillin are moving over. Control still looks like mom. Now, the next slide is going to be 2 days after starting a high-fat diet. The controls have all moved up into the high-fat category, some of the amoxicillin. These guys are starting to shift over. 60 days later, they're shifting. The high-fat is irresistible. 100 days, they're almost all over in the high-fat. This guy is still lagging from the antibiotic effect of 100 days before. Here's another way of looking at the aggregate. This is time. These are, each one's a mouse. These are the control mouse. They're mom type, and then they're fat type. Amoxicillin perturbs it, but not that much. But look at the macrolide. It perturbed it, and only finally did it come back to the fat type. It never returned to the mom type. So, and when we looked at the metagenome, the genes that are expressed, we also see a very deep branching. This is the tylosin and the amoxicillin group largely. These are the moms and the controls. Big difference in the genes that the microbes are carrying. How do we put this together? There are a number of different ways we can think about it. This is from classic ecological theory, the work of Payne 15 years ago. You have an ecosystem, you perturb it, it recovers. You perturb it twice, it doesn't recover. It's recovering and you perturb it, it doesn't recover. So what do we think is going on? In early life, there are stem cell populations. They have to make two decisions. How many times to go around, and do they become fat, muscle, or bone? There's been a lot of concentration on diet and calories, creating the context for this. We think that the microbes and the host immune responses are creating the context for this phenomenon as well, determining which is it going to be. Lots of people did this work. I've recognized many of them as I spoke. Here's the bigger group. Thank you, and I'm going to turn this over to John.
Here we go. Okay. Well, I'd like to echo the other speakers' thoughts in terms of it's really been an honor to be here and to talk to you tonight. I come from Cork in the very south of Ireland, so it's just across the water from Boston. So we feel very kindred towards Boston, being Irish. When Marty was talking there about different disciplines' view of the human body, if as a neuroscientist, our view really just is from the neck up. So traditionally, we don't, as neuroscientists, we don't tend to focus on what happens in other parts of the body. And what I want to share with you today is how that is changing, and how the field is, we're going to really appreciate how the microbiota within your gut can influence your brain and influence behavior and may play a role in a whole spectrum of disorders. And while I'm saying this is a new concept, it really isn't that new that microbiology and neuroscience collide. And we can just think back to neurosyphilis, and also more recently in the HIV infection, the awareness of the cognitive and other neurological impacts of HIV on the body. However, what I'm sharing with you in the neuroscience community is seen as being a little bit new and at times a little bit out there. But the concept is really about how the whole body operates and that the mind and body can work in concert to actually maintain homeostasis, and that within this we have various systems that communicate by different means. And the one that I'm talking about mainly today is the brain-gut axis, and this is the way that our brain and gut are very much primed to maintain this homeostatic need. And this is been very well studied in trying to understand the concepts of satiety and food intake, and is very much appreciated in that field. And what I want to get across today is how this can also extend to other areas of neuroscience. So my real interest is in the neurobiology of stress. and how stress affects the system. And really, it's like, as Marty just said, it's about a perturbation that occurs, and stress is that type of perturbation, and it can be acute or it can be more chronic. And in the society, in the Western world that we're living in, there's a lot more stresses, be they financial, be they work-related, be they the turning on the television, etc. But it's clear that stress is something that we have to deal with. And it's very important to take into account what Hans Selye said, who's the guy who coined the term stress. It's not stress that kills us, but our individual reaction to it. And this idea of trying to understand the susceptibility factors that prime us for stress and stress sensitivity is very important. And indeed, in Nature, just a few months ago, talked about this in the context of resilience. Because also the flip side of that is understanding what resilience to stress and what are the molecular and neurobiological mechanisms that are priming for that. And that maybe the take-home message from my talk is that maybe the microbiota might be playing a role in stress susceptibility as well as stress resilience. The other important thing that I want to impart on you is that stress is a whole body syndrome. It affects every aspect of the body. We study it very well in terms of its impact on the hormonal system, the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, but it also affects clear circuits within the brain. It has direct effects on the immune system, but also locally in the gut, there are major impact of stress on motility, on barrier function, as well as on responsivity to a variety of hormones, such as CRF. And then they're again going at the communications between the gut and the brain that the stress can impact on. And on the vagus nerve is one here that I'll talk about a little later. And again, I don't have to delay on this slide. We've heard it very nicely from the three previous talks, but it's just to introduce the gut microbiome and how important it is in our lives. And here we have the view from how could the gut microbiome affect brain function. And really what we're realizing is that there are numerous ways within this gut-brain axis that bacteria can influence. They can produce neurotransmitters or short-chain fatty acids. They can impact immune cells. They can affect on the HPA axis, on metabolism of key amino acids like tryptophan, which are very important for the maintaining certain neurotransmitters in the brain. And so we're beginning to slowly tease apart these mechanisms. And in doing so, we're putting knowledge together to try and understand how something that's going on locally within your gut can impact what's going on in the brain and therefore affect mood, cognition, emotion, and perhaps visceral pain. And so there are different ways that many of which have been talked about by the previous speakers. We can administer various bacteria in the form of probiotics, the various antibiotic studies, fecal transplantation studies, which we heard about earlier. Studies from infection, be it H. pylori or other infections, are giving great knowledge to what's going on in this communication, as well as what we've heard a lot about is germ-free animals. And the concept that stress could affect the bacteria in our guts is actually not a new one at all. And it dates back to studies from Tannock 40 years ago, where they show that stress mice show dramatic reductions in the population of lactobacilli within the gut. And lactobacilli are often seen as some of the good bacteria within the gut. And other studies, both in monkeys and in rodents, have also shown that, including studies we were interested in, because we're particularly interested in stress in early life, because we know that if you are stressed during the early years of life, you have a greater susceptibility to develop major psychiatric illness such as depression or major functional gastrointestinal disorders like irritable bowel syndrome. And so we look at a model of early life stress in the rat, which is called the maternal separation model. And I won't go into details, but just to point out that when you stress rats in early life by taking away their mother for basically 10 days during their first 2 weeks, you can see their behavioral changes, their endocrine changes, their immune changes, their changes locally in the gut. And what we showed in this paper for the first time, using rather crude techniques at the time, was that the composition of the microbiota in the gut in these animals, when they grew up, was quite different than the controls, and so that it wasn't as diverse as in the controls. And this allowed us to think, well, there's something happening early on that's changing the way the gut flora is being able to drive its impact on physiology later on. So germ-free mice we've heard about, and basically the way to study this in one way is this microbiota gut-brain axis is basically obliterate the microbiota and see what happens. And so germ-free mice allow us to do this. And the first study from this came from Sudo's group in Japan, a very seminal paper that was neglected for a few years and then has been very widely cited in the last few years, where he showed that animals that grew up without bacteria in their guts had a much more pronounced response to a stressor. So these are hormones, these are stress hormones, ACTH and corticosterone, and when these animals were restrained, you got an increase in these hormones, and it was greatly exaggerated in germ-free animals. And when they put back bacteria into these animals, so colonize them with bifidobacteria, you're able to basically return to the normal stress response. So this tells us that bacteria within your gut are very important for how you mount an acute stress response. And then what about brain development and brain function? And a series of papers, the first one emerging from Sven Pedersen's group at Karolinska and others from Jane Foster and John Bielenstock in Canada, as well as our own, has shown that these germ-free animals have alterations in brain development and basically changes in behavior that are abnormal. So if you grow up without your bacteria during early life, and it's critical that it's done in early life, because when we put back in the bacteria in adolescence, we were not able to restore all of the effects. So there's a change going on in early life that the bacteria are very important for the development of the brain. And I'll show you some of the data here just to show BDNF, which is a neurotrophic factor. It's very important for learning and memory and plasticity within the hippocampus, which is the key brain region involved in learning, in cognition and learning and memory, that there is less of this in germ-free animals. We also showed, what Sudo showed, that the stress hormones were exaggerated. So what this tells us is that having abnormal bacteria or absence of bacteria during early life will result in altered brain function. And the other method that people have begun to use clinically and slowly beginning to back translate into animals is the fecal microbiota transplantation. And this is very widely used in the context of C. difficile infection, where it can be a real lifesaver. And this is shown here in this editorial just last week in the New England Journal of Medicine, and it's been characterized in all of the lay press because it has the yuck factor, basically, where people are able to take the good bacteria from a donor and basically allow them to survive the C. difficile infection. Well, could this be applied to other aspects of physiology and behavior? And buried in a big, excellent paper from Steve Collins and Chemik Berchik's group in Canada, but buried in that paper in 2011 is this very interesting study where they showed that two strains of mice, one is called a Swiss mouse, the other is a Babs mouse, and these strains of mice differ very much in their reckless behavior, in their locomotor behavior and their anxiety response. And when they place these mice on an elevated platform, the normal Swiss mouse will jump off very quickly, and a Babs mouse is much more scared and stays on this platform. And this is their normal response. But what they did was they did a fecal microbiota transplantation from the Babs mouse onto this mouse and showed that its whole behavior changed just by changing its bacteria. And the same, they were able to recapitulate this in the Babs mice by giving it the Swiss Webster mouse. So this really opens up the concept that perhaps if you want to change your behavior, that perhaps changing your microbiota might be a way of doing it. But you'd want to be very careful who your donor is and that they have a good psychological profile overall. And as we heard already, there are many natural ways that you can modify your microbiota that may feed into this. So we, and the other area that we method that we were interested in, as I mentioned, was giving probiotic-like bacteria to adult animals in normal animals that are not sick. Is there some way that we could modify their behavior relevant to anxiety or depression? And studying anxiety and depression in rodents is and in animal models in general is very difficult. And I like this cartoon from Gary Larson, not just because it's an Irish setter, but it sums up the difficulty we have in the biological psychiatry field in terms of trying to model complex aspects of behavior. And so we can't just put our mouse or our rat on the couch and ask it how it's feeling in certain ways. And so we have these assays that we use that have their drawbacks and have their advantages, but we were interested to use some of these assays and see how mice would respond after treatment with a lactobacillus, in this case a lactobacillus rhamnosus, for a number of weeks. The first thing we did was we stressed the animals and looked at their physiological response. If you're stressed, you get a physiological increase in body temperature. We found there was a slight but not significant but a reduction in the stress response in these animals if they'd been given the bacteria. But the most striking responses was in this elevated plus maze. This plus-shaped apparatus is used to test for novel anxiety drugs. So if you put a mouse on this here, it will spend most of the time in the closed arms. That means it wants to be quite safe. These are quite, it's dark, it's nice for the mice. But if you give that mouse Valium, it'll come out here, it'll look all around, it'll wonder, and we do this, believe it or not, to see what happens. And basically, when we give the mice the lactobacillus, they behaved as if they were on Valium already. And so they had much more entries into the open arms. This is a behavioral despair test where we put mice into a swimming chamber and allow them to swim around, and they are looking for an escape route. Mice can swim very well, so it's nothing wrong with that, but they don't like the water. So, but eventually they will become immobile and they'll give up. They realize there's no escape out of this situation. And this model, if you give the animals antidepressant drugs, they will keep looking for an escape route and be motivated and increase their and reduce their behavioral despair. And again, this is widely used by the pharmaceutical industry to screen for novel antidepressant drugs. And basically, these animals behaved like they were already on Prozac, so they had a reduction in their immobility. So that was behavior. What about physiology? And this was even more striking. When we stress the animals, you get this increase in corticosterone, the main hormone. It's like cortisol. In humans, and the animals that have been given the lactobacillus had a much blunted response. So they were more chilled out. They didn't have the same stress response as compared to animals just given a broth. When we looked at the brains of these animals, we were really surprised to see profound changes in the receptors for the main inhibitory neurotransmitter, GABA. Now, GABA is what Valium works on. Basically, Valium acts on the GABA receptors, and specifically this GABA-A receptor. And what we found was robust changes in this receptor in a variety of brain areas. And I won't go into the details, but just to show you that there are very marked and reproducible changes in GABA receptors, both GABA-A and GABA-B, in animals that have been fed this lactobacillus. So this really got us thinking, is how could bacteria in your gut be communicating up to the brain and changing the concentration of neurotransmitters, chemicals within your brain? And looking at it, back to this schematic I showed you in the beginning at the different routes of communication, I mentioned this vagus nerve, and this is a really key communicator between everything that's going on below the neck and the brain. And so we together with John Beeningstock's group in McMaster, we performed vagotomy, basically cut the vagus nerve, fed the animals the bacteria, and the take-home message, and I won't go into the details, is that all of the effects of the bacteria were abolished on behavior, on neurochemistry, etc. So it tells us basically that this vagus nerve is very important for mediating communication between the gut and the brain, and what happens in vagus will affect your emotion. So what about the clinical situation? Well, it's too early. is my take-home message on that. I'm sure some of you will want to talk about this later, but the studies just haven't been done. And the studies need to be done at the same with the same rigor as they would be if they were carried out in for a new pharmaceutical agent. However, there are some interesting hints. This is a study from France which looked at a cocktail of probiotics in healthy volunteers, but were able to judge them based on their normal anxiety and the normal range of anxiety and depression-like symptoms in these healthy volunteers, and were able to show that this bacteria was able to have psychobiotic effects and basically diminish the anxiety and depression-like behavior in this. Work that was presented at numerous meetings and is still not published from the UCLA group of Emmerin Meyer and colleagues is really putting this to the test empirically by looking at neuroimaging studies, and they've shown that just like our rodent studies, where we fed healthy rodents a bacteria and saw changes in brain activity, they've shown resting state activity in healthy volunteers was changed by a cocktail of probiotics. We're at an early stage, but we're beginning to translate these effects into the human scenario. The question is, will they ever be able to develop psychobiotics for clinical depression or anxiety? We're still at an early stage. However, it's worth noting that these bacteria are real factories for producing neurotransmitters and other bioactives that are going to have an impact on brain function. These are just some studies from colleagues in Cork showing the bifidobacteria producing GABA, and then Mark Light has summarized all of the different bacteria that are available and what are the neurotransmitters that they're actually able to produce. So in conclusion, I really want to impress on you that basically what's happening in your gut under normal status will impact what's going on in your brain and help you maintain a healthy CNS function. Under certain circumstances of stress, and we're particularly interested not just in acute stress, but in chronic repeated stress, and stress at the extremes of life will affect abnormal gut function, and then lead to abnormal CNS function, and vice versa. Abnormal CNS function perhaps also changes what's going on in gut physiology. So you can see that it's something like a Downton Abbey effect. What's happening downstairs, when everything is going normal, no one notices it upstairs at all what's going on. But when things start to go awry downstairs, it starts to become, people begin to notice it upstairs. So that's my take-home message for you today, and I leave you with this cartoon that the Daily Mail in the UK published when our paper came out about the opportunities for developing psychobiotics. So thank you very much. And in particular, I'd like to thank my colleague, Professor Ted Dynan, the Chair of Psychiatry in Cork, who we do all this work together. So now we're going to have a round table with the four speakers discussing some of the key points.
So I think we'll start the round table with some questions from within the group, and then we'll open it up to the crowd in just a little while. I'll start out with kind of a controversial question. So every day when I show up at the office, I'm confronted with several dispensers for Purell. So, you know, I can completely eradicate all the microbes in my skin microbiome. What do you guys think about this? Is this a good idea, or in what situations? Certainly, I hope that my doctor uses it when he's about to perform surgery on me, something like that, but should I be using it to go to the office or not?
Should I jump in? So there are places to use Purell. If you're in the hospital, if there are a lot of sick people around hospitals, there's a lot of spread of germs. We don't want to do that. But the concept of Purell is that microbes are bad, and we have to get rid of them. And Purell is getting rid of the good microbes.
And whether Perel is helping us or hurting us, I don't know.
I don't know either.
Nor I.
Well, that question was less controversial than I thought.
I have another question for you guys, just in general. And you've alluded to a little bit, but in certain countries, there has been a huge upsurge in the amount of elective cesarean section that's going on. Is this a time bomb for diseases that we don't know? Because we know that there's an increased risk for allergy and immune disorder and type 1 diabetes in cesarean, but I'm just curious what, like in Brazil.
Sure. Well, there are, as you say, there are statistical associations between C-section and a lot of these, especially autoimmune disorders. It seems very likely that increasing the rate of C-section unnecessarily is going to lead to much higher incidence, and we don't really know what's going to go on decades down the track. It's certainly a procedure that evolutionarily has never existed, right? Where as mammals, we're all adapted to the microbes that we expect to get passing through the birth canal, which until a couple of hundred years ago was the way all of us got here and survived to adulthood. So I think we're really getting into territory that hasn't been explored previously by any mammalian species.
And it's also interesting to note that those microbes are largely the lactobacillus that we've been talking about as the beneficial probiotic organisms that also, you know, colonize the gut in early life.
And I'll just continue again on a non-controversial theme. When people were, cesarean sections have been around for about 100 years and they've done enormous good, but no one ever considered the idea that mothers were transmitting their own microbes to their babies as part of the heritage that the babies are getting. And as Rob said, there have been studies now that show that the babies of women who've had C-sections are at high risk for becoming obese. In fact, there was a study here in Boston that showed that, that was published earlier this year. We have a second study from England that shows the same phenomenon.
And there's a third one from Canada about to come out also showing the same thing. So it seems to be very reproducible.
And it's consistent with the hypothesis that the founding microbes are very important in later life development. So I wanted to ask Eric about those 300 variables that you were looking at, and because it's a lot of data, but you also have a lot of genetic data, which are the 16S results. Were you able to find any strong characters other than the dietary ones?
Yeah, so the table I showed was pretty much all the strong correlations that we found. So yeah, I mean there were surprisingly few. At the end of the day, we had to ask, gosh, was it really worth all that recording? I think it was, if only to rule out certain factors. So you know, we actually recorded how much time we spent recording, and for me it was about 8 hours a week. So it was like a day of you know, activity lost. But
almost like prayer.
Oh, I think we hit upon a controversial topic. fairly surprised that we didn't find more.
So which activity were you most surprised did not affect the microbiome?
So I thought for sure, you know, every night we went out and had a few too many beers to drink, and we repeated that experiment over and over. because as you know, Rob, the, you know, statistical power depends on that reproducibility. I was surprised that didn't have an effect, because we know there's certain microbes that can, you know, utilize ethanol and some that can't.
Oh, absolutely. Well, given the effect size that you did see, how much more would you have to drink for it to be statistically significant? And are you looking for additional subjects in that study?
We can talk about that after. Yeah.
Okay.
So, John,
should we take some questions, or?
Let me Let me just ask you, John, you mentioned about the vagus, which is the kind of highway of nervous impulses going in both directions. And we know it's that there's a lot going from the brain down. Is there any way to say what the magnitude of the signals going up? Is it the minority?
We don't know right now in terms of the, because we don't really know how the bacteria are really getting to the vagus. So there's still that in-between bit that we need to figure out. I mean, is it the enteric nervous system or what that's causing the connection? So we were surprised in our studies just how much everything was dependent on vagus. Other people have done other studies with other bacteria and performed vagotomy and not found it having the same impact. So it'll always be strain of bacteria dependent, and understanding that mechanism. There are probably other mechanisms at play as well, including the immune system.
Yeah, and I'll just note that in collaboration with a good colleague of mine, Susan Erdman at MIT, you know, we've been looking at probiotics and, inspired by your study, have started doing vagotomies, and we really do see the effect of the probiotic diminished by the vagotomies. Yeah.
Okay, we ready for questions? Okay, first question's over here.
Thank you very much, all four of you. I'm up in the back. Thank you very much, all four of you. It's very, very impressive listening to this. It was hard not to look at some of the studies that you did and see some of the correlations, and as my mind raced through them, I started thinking about our food sources, for the how drastically they've changed for the past decades, and the mentions of so many more diseases, maybe neurological or behavioral conditions coming up now that maybe weren't noticed in the past. We know that science doesn't always have the strength to help policy change, and in fact, there's always many agendas that are more powerful than the science to keep policy the way they are or oriented towards other people's agendas. But do you see any of the conclusions, maybe with the correlations we're seeing between the diet of our diets, maybe some of the data sets you're putting up there, maybe starting to have a little more traction in the policy in regards to where our food sources come from, especially how we're noticing the major components of our food is becoming far more unnaturally created and produced to feed the populations? And any, just to back up, any correlation between our food production, our diets, and many more conditions in the biology of our systems and our neurobiology and so on?
Well, certainly one of the policy decisions that I kind of alluded to and Marty talked about more explicitly is the use of the subtherapeutic antibiotics. I think, policy is shifting to follow more of the European model where, you know, we recognize that that's a bad thing. And I hope to some extent we can... our studies would lend some ammunition to those arguments, but I think maybe Marty has more to say on it.
So we began the studies in the mice with the subtherapeutic antibiotics to find a model that might be relevant to human kids, thinking that if farmers feed antibiotics to their farm animals and their animals change development and they get fat, what are we doing to our kids? But the more we've explored this, the more we're interested in what Eric has found, which is that there's evidence that those antibiotics are getting into our that they're retained in our food in small amounts, but they're present, and they're selecting our microbes. And in fact, it used to be much worse, that the levels in meat, in milk, in water were up in the hundreds of micrograms per day. Now we're down to the tens of micrograms per day because there's better regulation. But it's actually still extremely unnatural, and what Eric is finding is the proof that these antibiotics that are used on the farm, there's supposed to be a time, a washout time, that when the farmers feed the antibiotics to their farm animals, they stop a number of days before slaughter. This clearly is not happening in every case, and so our meat, our milk, and water has trace amounts of antibiotics. And I wonder how that's affecting development, at the least.
One other thing that's fascinating, in addition to Eric's really groundbreaking work on showing how much transfer there is between these different systems that we're selecting with antibiotics, is that Pete Tenbaugh at Harvard just has a paper out recently that shows that antibiotics not only kill a fairly large number of the microbes, but also the microbes that survive have very different patterns of gene expression. So even the ones that survive are doing very different things after they've been exposed to antibiotics. And I think those effects, and especially their effects on signaling to the host in the gut, are just starting to be unraveled now.
Next question up here.
Hi, I had a question on cesarean sections. And actually, Marty, particularly to you, since you spend a lot of your time in the hospital, the data you all guys have showed on cesarean is really disturbing, all the associations. And there also seems to be data that indicates that some of the cesareans are may be questionable or not really necessary. For example, you see that around lunchtime and dinner time, somehow cesarean rates seem to go up. Do you think, from the hospital management point of view, that there may be some changes coming up soon because of potential liability?
Historically, cesarean rates have been around 10 to 15%. And in the last 30 years in the United States, they've doubled. It's more than 30% now. In some places, in Rome, it's 80%. In Brazil, it's more than 50%. It's not just the United States. Even in China, in the big urban areas, it's approaching 50%. And it's for many reasons. Certainly, convenience of doctors, billing, those are important. Also, when people didn't think that there was any cost to cesarean, when they thought it was only benefit, women would think, well, I should get a cesarean because it'll lower complications. The Italian women who are only having one baby, they want to make sure that it's absolutely perfect, as if the cesarean could give them perfection. But the problem, among others, is the changed transfer of the microbes. And another related problem is all the antibiotics that women are getting during pregnancy. More than half the women today in the United States are getting antibiotics in pregnancy, usually late in the term. And that has to affect the founding bacteria in the new baby.
Next question over here.
One of the things that kind of surprised me wasn't so much the aspect of the gut microbes affecting obesity and affecting how the body processes nutrition, but more the other way around, that they would change in response to diet. I'm not sure if it's the same with the mood stuff. I guess you were saying there wasn't a huge correlation with mood and the microbiome, but I'm curious if, when that's the case, why there's so much of, like, even a cliche as far as dieting. You lose weight, you go off the diet, and then, or it just becomes hard to maintain. Like, wouldn't there be a feedback loop? I'm just curious about that. A related question, I was just curious, since they've seen so much success in terms of fecal transplants for certain diseases, why that's not being done as almost like an elective thing where they're trying, like, let's take a thin person's feces and just, you know, grind it up and. And are we going to get to a future where, you know, in addition to, like, blood banks and sperm banks, we have fecal banks? So, thanks.
Yeah, so that's a great question. We've always thought, what a great business idea. We could sell Tom and Giselle's poop, and, you know, people could eat it, and, yeah. That's a very timely question, because there's some concern right now that the FDA is going to impose regulations that make it very difficult for doctors to use fecal transplants, or at least to do research on fecal transplants. So right now, there's clearly evidence that it's very, very effective for recurring C. diff infections. In terms of other GI conditions, everybody's really interested, right? But the studies are just beginning, and right now, you know, we're all kind of looking around, wondering if, you know, wondering how difficult it's going to be to kind of do that.
I just want to continue on this line. What we're talking about are infections due to C. difficile, and some of these are very, very severe infections. People die from C. difficile. So it's a very severe acute infection. And what the recent study confirmed, there was an impression that fecal transplants work. The recent study in the Netherlands confirmed that this was much better than any current therapy. In fact, they had to stop the trial because it worked so well. And what was interesting is that it wasn't just one person's feces that were protective, that were curative. It was feces from any number of people, many normal people. And that established the proof of principle that the feces from normal people had some restorative power. And now the scientific problem is now going to be to figure out what was it? Was it one particular bacterium? Was it a group of bacteria? Was it a certain ecotype? Were there certain metabolic pathways that were overrepresented? So this, the proof of principle is really going to spur the scientific development to come up with something much cleaner. And those principles it will now extend to other diseases that are not as severe as lethal C. diff.
Right, and one very important question is whether the right fecal donor is the right one, whether the same fecal donor is the right one for everybody, or whether you need to do a careful screening procedure to find the donor that matches individual cases. And we just don't know the answer to that with the current state of the research. There has been some really interesting work in Europe looking at fecal transplantation for diabetes and insulin resistance, and so that hasn't been formally published except as a meeting abstract so far, to my knowledge. But certainly the potential is huge if the regulatory issues can be overcome.
And regarding your question about mood and diet, I mean, that link is very well defined in terms of there are specific foods that are and specific populations that eat certain foods where have a different susceptibility to mood disorders. What's missing right now is linking that to the microbiome, and them studies haven't been really done in populations of, say, depressed or anxious individuals and looked at that in an empirical way. And maybe there could be something in bringing that whole axis together.
One thing I just note, because I think you're referring to the fact that, you know, I kept track of my mood data and microbiome. When I started the study, and you know this better than I do, my impression was that my mood changes all the time. You know, I get some bad news and I'm in a bad mood. I get good news and I'm in a great mood. What actually surprised me, because I had to record in real time, is that the sort of ups and downs of everyday life. If I'm in a good mood and I get bad news, I'm like, oh, well, that's life. But if I was in a bad mood and I got good news, you know, I could just be cynical and say, well, sure, that's okay, but look at all these other terrible things. So I think the rate at which our mood changes is actually much slower than at least I thought, you know, when I started the study. So it's not surprising maybe that the day-to-day fluctuations in the microbiome didn't necessarily correlate with mood. It doesn't mean that, you know, some long-term exposure wouldn't have some effect.
Right, and speaking of rates of change in the microbiome, one thing that's interesting is that in humans, and this is based on work done at Penn that was published in Science a couple of years ago, so short-term diet has a statistically significant effect on the microbiome, but it's only long-term diet over the course of months or possibly years that really changes you relative to other people, rather than being a small change that you can detect, but isn't large compared to the differences between individuals. And so one thing that's interesting about that is with mice, you can shift their microbiome completely overnight by changing their diet. But with humans, the microbiome has a lot more inertia. And one thing that we're just starting to understand is what the right kinds of manipulations would be, and how long you have to apply them to be able to change your microbiome configuration appreciably and have that change be stable over time.
Next question here.
Thank you for this brilliant base that you're creating for the new medicine. My experiences have been that in the last several years, I've developed gastro problems. And having seen many practitioners in several relationships between gastro problems, that the traditional medical industry avoids it, doesn't want to think about it, and so I've been left to my own devices. I'm a chemist, so I've been using my own body also to try different things, and I found a connection between memory and other muscular performance and things like that. And so I began dosing on different types of probiotics. And I find that the different populations react with me differently. And I was wondering if you have any thoughts about what, from what we know at this point, what would be the most beneficial probiotic populations that we should be thinking about?
I think probably everybody has an opinion. One of the great things about living in a free country is that anybody can call something a probiotic. And so when you go in the health food store and somebody it says probiotic, it's not entirely clear what it is. And also, there's differences from lot to lot. So I personally think that there's a great future in probiotics, but it really has to be a scientific future where there are defined reagents and careful trials where we have endpoints that we can measure. And then we're going to figure out what are really the helpful ones.
So in my lab, we've been doing a lot of studies with probiotics. And if you were a mouse, you know, I could give you a lot of very specific advice. But in humans, we don't have quite as much data. But one of the things we notice in mice is that the anti-inflammatory probiotics seem to lead to slimmer body weights into old age. And that's one of the most dramatic effects that we observe. And there was the New England Journal of Medicine study maybe a year or so ago, which went through like 1.6 million years of patient data, so decades worth of data on hundreds of thousands of patients, and they categorize what are the foods that cause people to gain weight or not. And one of the really interesting things that kind of bucked the trend was yogurt, because it was very energy dense, and the average person filling out this questionnaire that says I eat X amount of yogurt is probably eating a fairly sugary yogurt, right? But even averaged over that very vague category, it was the strongest dietary factor that led to lower weight. So the more every extra serving of yogurt you had per day, you tended to lose something like 1.5 pounds every 4 years. Okay, so I think just simply because that was such a broad study with such a vague category of yogurt, and it really had the strongest impact of any dietary factor. Obviously, the general yogurt is doing something, and certainly we've tested a couple of off-the-shelf brands in mice, and they do seem to have the same effect. So I think in general, yogurt seems pretty good.
I'll just make the counter argument that people who eat yogurt are different than people who eat meat and potatoes. And so it has to be studied. It has to be very carefully studied.
Yeah, and in case you're wondering what the worst thing for you in that study was, it was French fries. Perhaps not too surprising.
But I would agree with, just to reinforce what Marty was saying in the context that the studies need to be done in proper clinical trials. In Europe, for example, the regulatory authority, EFSA, have had not approved any claim for any of these potential probiotics because the claims don't stack up yet. The trials don't stack up. We've reviewed it for irritable bowel syndrome, so there are certain probiotics of bifidobacteria or lactobacilla that seem to be, in small studies, seem to have some use in functional gastrointestinal disorders, but the types of trials need to be done properly.
Okay, we have a question up here.
Thank you for a great presentation. I'm interested in what's known about the connection between the microbiome and autoimmune diseases, MS specifically, which was mentioned in your brochure.
So
There have been some studies, again, they're rodent studies, which have shown enhanced susceptibility to some of the rodent models of MS in animals with perturbed microbiota. But again, that's only at its infancy in terms of teasing apart the mechanisms. There have been some papers.
We know already that certain organisms have very specific effects on different arms of immunity. And Eric mentioned certain kinds of organisms, and there are other organisms in experimental systems like mice where we know that certain organisms turn on a particular form of T cell or turn off a particular form. So the concept that the microbial composition is playing a role or could ameliorate chronic autoimmune diseases, I think is quite viable. But I think that one of the most important things that we can tell you is that this is an emerging field. We're really in pretty early days, but it's going to be an exciting field.
Yeah, I don't know, maybe some of you are familiar with this, but a lot of the motivation behind some of the probiotic work and other work is something called the hygiene hypothesis. And basically, the hypothesis states that one of the reasons that we're seeing an increase in some of these autoimmune-related disorders over the past few decades is simply because in early childhood, we're being exposed to a lower diversity of microbes. We're growing up in conditions that are more sterile than our immune system expects. And because we're not getting that correct early life exposure, now the immune system is out of whack and is responding badly to, you know, normal exposures. So that's one of the sort of, I think, pervasive ideas in the field. And there's certainly a lot of epidemiological evidence to support it. But we're, you know, I think there have been relatively few studies that are mechanistically kind of showing, exactly how this would take place.
Yeah, the point that all of these techniques are really new is a really important one, though. So, if you were looking at the dates of the journal articles that we were referring to on the slides, essentially all of them are 2007 or later, and in large part that just reflects this rapid transformation in the ability to use DNA sequences to understand what organisms are living on us and inside us, to understand what their genes are doing, and so forth. And so as a result, it's a really exciting time because we have all these tools available. The vast majority of studies that you could imagine doing are feasible now but have not yet been done. So you'll see a lot more coming out over the coming decade, I think.
Okay, we'll take one more question.
Next question right here.
Thank you. It was a great presentation. And I was just wondering if there's any, I remember reading a while back about the appendix and maybe possible restorative powers that it has after dysentery and things. And is there any kind of difference between the microbiome and the appendix and the rest of the colon, or does it respond differently after perturbation, that sort of thing?
It is many times as I've been asked that question. I think I get asked that question at the end of every single talk I give. I should figure out like what a reasonable answer would be, but I really don't have one. I mean, it sounds like a great study, right? Look at the microbiome and the stability of the microbiome and folks that have had their appendix out or not. I don't know anybody who's doing that study, but somebody should. Rob, are you doing it?
No, I'm not, but I know someone who is. As far as I know, there's nothing published on it yet, but it's a really exciting question.
Yeah, I agree. Could we take one more question? That young man over here has had his hand up for quite a time. I'd love to hear what he'd like to ask.
Would physical things like running affect your microbiome?
So I can say, so one of the counter effects of recording all of the information about your daily life for all of your, friends and relatives and peers to see is that You know, it makes it really easy to like start eating a lot of salads and start running a lot and things like this. So I actually got on quite a health kick and running kick during the study. So, but you know, unfortunately, we didn't see any immediate impact on the microbiome.
On the other hand, in mice, the answer is yes. And there's a fairly extensive field of exercise immunology, where if you exercise a whole lot, then that has a bad effect on your immune system. But if you exercise moderately, that has a beneficial effect. And so the people who have been studying that for about a decade are now starting to get really interested in the idea that a lot of those interactions might be due to the microbes rather than due to just the host immune system.
Also, from a neuroscience perspective, the people are really beginning to appreciate the impact of running on brain function and plasticity and stress, the ability to counteract stress. So, again, rodent studies are really suggesting that running could be beneficial in that way. And so, therefore, that's going to have knock-on effects.
Well, that was just pretty mind-blowing. And what an amazing treat to have these gentlemen who are really at the forefront of this exciting field letting us know what they are finding. It's really, thank you so much.